Well, let's just say that the manager of the Green Mill will never forget me. Let's just put it that way, okay? But before I walked out of there, three of his waiters have my book, One Heartbeat Away, in their hands, and they have the truth about the Lord Jesus Christ, too. And I have a real simple motto: if you don't want my Jesus, you don't want my money. But if you want my Jesus, you can have my money. I will give it to you. Matter of fact, one of his waiters last night that I witnessed to invited me back in this evening to talk to him a second time. Okay? So remember, you don't have to worry about that. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much. It's a great chance to be here. Father God, Holy Spirit, move across these hearts. Glorify your name. Tough talk. Been giving it around the country. A lot of people's lives have been challenged and changed by this Holy Spirit. You've hit some hearts. We have the truth of your scripture. Father, glorify your name and your name only. And we thank you for that, and we do. And we ask it in the great, great name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen, amen. Okay, take your Bibles for me, please. All right? Now, we're about to open up this book. All right, but do me a favor. When you open up this book, do not open this book up like a newspaper. Do not open up this book like a textbook. Do not open up this book like a fiction book. This is the word of Almighty God, is that correct? That is correct. When you open this book up, every single time have expectations. I expect God every single time I open up this book to drill me. But when he drills, it hurts sometimes, doesn't it? Because he's trying to mold and shape you into the men and women of God he wants you to be. I have expectations every time I open up this book. We're about to open up this book. Have grand expectations what the Lord may do, okay? Go to the book of Revelations. Go to Revelations chapter 3 for me. We're going to talk about the church of Laodicea. Revelations chapter 2 and chapter 3 list the seven churches in the book of Revelations, and many people think they're dispensations of time, that each one is a time period. Interesting, I'm not exactly sure about that, but if that's true, the Laodicean church would be the last church that would be alive before the Lord Jesus Christ came back, okay? If it's true, that means we would be this church right here. We can read through this and find out if that's even a possibility, okay? Let's read. Revelations chapter 3. We're going to start at verse 14, all right? And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and the true witness, the beginning of the creation of God, okay? First point, don't miss this. It is written to the Laodiceans. It says in the King James, it's the only one of the seven churches written to individuals in the church. Not the church of Sardis, not the church of Philadelphia, the church of the Laodiceans. This is an individual call here that God is making with this church. Why would it switch on the seventh one? There's a very specific reason why. We'll show you in a couple minutes, okay? And it says, in the faithful and true witness. I got a question for you. Aren't you looking for truth in the end of days? Let me tell you something, you need truth and nothing else. When I talk with lost people, I talked with some lost people last night at the Mall of America, and I made a very simple statement. Remember, don't search for something to believe in, search for the truth, right? Right, I challenge people with truth all the time. Well, if the true witness, the Lord Jesus Christ is speaking, should we pay attention? Big attention, okay? Laodicea was a very famous city, very wealthy city, kind of like a New York or a Paris, okay? Watch where we go, go to verse 15, all right? I know thy works. You cannot hide things from the Lord Jesus Christ. You can hide your sin from your parents. You can hide your sin from your friends. You hide nothing before the Lord Jesus Christ. Is that correct? I know thy works. Thou art neither cold nor hot. I wish they were cold or hot. Okay? See, you've become in the middle of what's happening here. You're not cold, you're not hot. Okay? On a scale of 0 to 10, the 10, that radical, bold witnesser for Jesus Christ, loves the Lord, worships the Lord, shares his faith, her faith, just it's all Jesus, that 10. But then we got that 0, that atheist, that agnostic that wants nothing to do with this. Keep your Jesus Christ to yourself. Are you born again? Leave me alone, okay? Nothing to do with it. A 0 or a 10, but wait, he doesn't leave it there. Okay? Because what he's worrying about here, cold or hot, is the 4, 5, or 6, this middle, this mushy middle, if you're stuck right here in the middle. Not quite super serious about it, not really like that lost guy, but just kind of stuck in the middle. Okay? A 4, 5, or 6, where would you put your number at if God asked you to put a number on your faith? 4, 5, or 6, kind of like 50% effort. for Almighty God. Let me ask you a question. If you played college basketball and your coach at Indiana or your coach at Texas Tech was someone by the name of Bobby Knight, okay, and you decided to give Coach Knight 50% effort in a practice, how long you think that'll last before Coach Knight might say something to you? Okay, 3-4 minutes max, okay? Coach Knight would go, at the end of a 2-hour practice, Mark, come here. Thank you so much for giving 50%. Come here, give me a hug, okay? Do you think Coach Knight would do that? Absolutely not. But see, we think we have this huggy little Jesus that will be happy with our 40, 50, 60% pittance of effort as we're much more concerned about other things. But God says, I love you so much, I'll give you my true opinion, okay? Go to verse 16. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spew thee out of my mouth. I will spit you out of my mouth. Your translation says, I might vomit you out of my mouth. The word means a violent reaction. It is so disgusting to Jesus Christ, he must get you away from him at this moment. I have had food poisoning 3 different times where I wound up in hospitals, and one was just about a month ago, okay? And let me tell you something, when that food poisoning hits, and I was in an emergency room, and it was ugly, okay? But when that poison, that junk had to get out of you, it has to get out of you, or you're gonna die if the poison stays in you. But my body was having this violent reaction, okay? Because that was just, I had to get rid of it because it was disgusting. I wonder if the Lord Jesus Christ looked at your church that you go to and say, I have to get rid of that church, it's disgusting. Question for you, can the Christian, the life of a Christian, make God sick to his stomach, yes or no? Yes or no?
Yes.
You better believe it. And the question is, are you one of those people? Is your church one of those churches? See, the thing is, the zero hasn't fooled himself. Okay? The 4, 5, and 6 have fooled themselves. I was on a plane flight the other day and I started witnessing to a young man next to me, Steve. He was an Air Force police officer for the Air Force. He just came back from Uzbekistan, 21-year-old guy. He had a cache full of weapons with him, okay, all these weapons. One was a rocket-propelled grenade launcher, okay? I have decided if you have a rocket-propelled grenade launcher, we're going to be friends. So we were friends. And so we're talking. I'm witnessing to him, okay? He wants nothing to do with this, okay, nothing. He cursed more times in 1.5 hours than I've probably heard in my lifetime. He didn't care if I was a minister or a preacher. He could care less, okay? He was himself, okay? He was just, that was him. That was his life, okay? But see, he hadn't fooled himself. He wanted nothing to do with this. During the conversation, I asked him, I said, Steve, you ever thought about death before? He said, no, not really. I said, excuse me, you're a patrol officer, an officer for the Air Force. You've never thought about death? He said, well, the other day in Uzbekistan, this guy came over the fence and was running towards this big transport plane, had a, you know, like a turban on his head, and I had my gun up ready to shoot this guy. I said, you pull the trigger? He said, no. I said, why? He said, I couldn't do it. Put his gun down, went running around. By the time he got the other side of the plane, some other officers had got him over there. He was 15 years old, just a few years earlier. Him and his brother walk into a bank. As they walk into a bank, he had a Glock 9mm put to his head. He walked in the middle of a bank robbery, okay? Get on the ground right now. These bank robbers, he told me, were famous for killing people in every robbery, okay? He didn't get shot, he didn't get killed, okay? I began to witness this kid. He began to have questions. See, we began to talk. I shared the truth with him, gave him my new book, One Heartbeat Away, gave it to him. He said, all of a sudden, he said, excuse me, Mark, can I have an extra one of those? I said, why? He said, because my brother does exactly what I do in Japan, and all my brother does when he's on his base in Japan is talk Christians out of their faith. That's what he does when they go to church on Sunday. Excuse me, why are you going to church? Can you prove there's a God? Can you prove the Bible's true? And he talks his friends out of their faith. Excuse me, could someone talk you out of your faith today? Give it your best shot with me, it's not possible. I'm past the point of believing, I know this to be true. I know the tomb's empty, where are you at? If you're still just believing and you don't know yet, you're in trouble in the days to come. Okay, he said, can I have a book for my brother to get to him? This kid, Steve, we had the best time. See, his heart was pliable. You could poke his heart and he'd be, but the 4, 5, and 6, the people's pride has gotten away. I'm okay. I said that prayer back when I was 8 years old. I'm fine, okay? I go to church when, you know, when I need to. I don't really read the Bible, but I'm okay. I've got my little get out of hell free card. to show to the Lord when I walk out of here. The Bible doesn't have get out of hell free cards in it. It has commitments to Lord Jesus Christ in it, surrendered lives to Jesus Christ in it. What camp would you fall into? See, the zeros will listen. The four, fives, and the sixes won't. I was in Atlanta at a big music festival, started witnessing these two guys, drinks in one hand, cigarettes in the other hand, and their hats said All-American Drinking Team on the top. Yet give me every right answer about Jesus Christ, because they grew up in church, but not enough to change their life. Let me tell you something. The Bible does not say, I know you by your words. I know you by your what? Your fruit, your action. How shall it be? A youth pastor just emailed me. He was in Gatlinburg, Tennessee. Gatlinburg Christian conferences all the time. He witnesses to the lady behind the counter at the hotel. At the end, he says, excuse me. He said, has anyone ever shared this with you before about Jesus Christ? He said, well, she said, let me be honest. I've worked here for 12 years at this hotel. I can count on my hand, one hand, the number of times someone has witnessed to me about Jesus Christ. What are you doing, Christian folk? Checking into your hotels? Got your nice, comfortable room? How about the person when you checked in at? How about Corey and Tammy, the two lost people I chatted with at the Hampton Inn where you checked in at today? Were you concerned about their soul? Were you concerned about the soul of the waiter and waitress tonight when you stopped and ate? Or was I just too busy because I had to get on this conference on time because my agenda is a little bit different than the Lord's agenda? How is that to be true? I just spoke at a big youth conference, and I went to eat the third day of this conference at this place, began to witness to the waiter. Finished, fascinating conversation. I asked him the question. I said, you've had this youth pastor convention for 3 days. I'm assuming you've waited a lot of these people. I said, yeah, I've been serving these guys all this whole time. I said, have any of them ever taken the time to talk with you about what it takes to be saved? The guy looked and said, in all my years of being a waiter, I've never had one single time except this afternoon someone has talked to me about what it takes to be saved. Let me tell you something. That's a sign of a lukewarm church. A lukewarm church that doesn't care about souls, trust me, you're in danger. And remember, God gave his opinion on that, what he will do with that. Think about that. If you're more concerned about a football game, if you're more concerned, okay, about going to school, getting your paycheck, going to work, if you're more concerned about a World Series game you're missing tonight, okay, be careful. You're officially going to be lukewarm very soon. I had a ticket to the World Series on Tuesday, and it offered me by one of the players because his wife read one of my books, got to meet with him. Just a fantastic Christian family. They invited me to the World Series. I turned the ticket down and decided not to go, and my friends are killing me back home. But let me tell you something. I have the hardest time sitting in a stadium with 50,000 people worshiping something that does not matter the day you die. I have the hardest time with that because I used to play college sports. I used to be in arenas like that. In Atlanta, when they throw events like that, we go down every single time and hand tracks out, talk to people, witness. We can't wait. We get the Final Four in just a few months. In Atlanta, we'll be down there all 3 days of that, reaching lost people for Jesus Christ. See, you got to be careful. Are you migrating to the 4, 5, and 6? Be very careful in the days to come, okay? Look at the bulletins at your church. What's on the front of so many bulletins? The church building. Because that's the most thing we're prideful of. We love our building that we're in. Excuse me, the church is not the building. Aren't there a picture of people on the front? Because that's what matters when it's said and done. Is that right? That is right. This place is all going to be under fire one day and be long gone. What are you searching after? What are you chasing after? The Chinese church, there's a book called Journey to Jerusalem. They decided they're going to take Jesus Christ out of China and start walking it straight into Jerusalem. They're going to take the gospel of Jesus Christ and bring it right to Jerusalem. There's one small problem. If you ever look at a map and these people start walking through, going to Jerusalem, there's a common denominator of all those countries. What's the common denominator? Radical what? Islam. And they know when they bring it through, they're danger. Persecution. They've been warned you're going to be persecuted and tribulation or come in your direction if you walk down this road. And the Chinese church people said, excuse me, we're already being persecuted. We already have tribulation. What's a little bit more? What's a little bit more? If you want to pray for revival to happen in America, one, start obeying what the scriptures say and go and reach and lost people. Two, pray for martyrdom to come to America. Pray that there'll be a cost to following Jesus Christ in other countries. Trust me, then you will decide whether you're going to put up or you're going to shut up for Jesus Christ. Is that right? That is right. What you didn't know about Columbine High School is the 15 people were killed at Columbine High School. 13 of the 15 were born-again evangelical Christians. It was a direct attack on Christianity. You did not get that on your news shows. One of the girls, Rachel Scott, that was killed there, I was talking with her sister at a conference, and she was shot outside the building. Eric Harris and them shot him outside, went in the building. A little bit later, came back out. He came back out. And the reason they know the story is because the boy laying next to Rachel there didn't die. He was just fake playing dead. I wonder how many of us today are just fake playing Christian. We think because we've said some prayer that we're going to be okay with Jesus Christ when we walk out of here and never made a commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ, surrendered life to Jesus Christ. Eric Harris came back outside, grabbed Rachel Scott by the nape of her neck, pulled her head up and said, "Do you still believe in your Jesus?" Turned her over, shot her, executed her in the back of the head. Shot 9 different times. Little tiny 80-pound girl. 9 different times for Jesus Christ. She wrote in her diary, I have it one of my books, a quote, paraphrasing, "If I have to go to school every single day to stand up for my best friend," what was his name? "Jesus Christ, and I lose all my other friends, he is worth it." A different mindset than most of us have today. But if Peter could come back, if Paul could come back, if Rachel could come back, it wouldn't be to take those exams they didn't get a chance to take. Let me go to the prom that she missed. They'd come back for one very specific reason. What would that be? Tell some lost people how real eternity is and how real the Lord Jesus Christ is. And you must repent and come to the cross of Jesus Christ, the blood that washes as pure and as white as snow now before you die, okay? Careful. A friend of mine was at a conference in 1993. He had a little book table doing his little books. 2 guys walk up, said, "What are your books about?" "It's on the biblical worldview through sports and stuff." He said, "Okay." Started talking, and this guy said, "Well, I'm the agent of this guy." He said, "And this guy here you haven't heard of yet, but you're going to hear about him, okay? Because he's going to change the way that we do church." And he said, "His name is Rick Warren." Excuse me, change the way that we do church? Church has been told how to do it right here. Church has been working just fine for 2,000 years, training up Christians to reach lost people. Okay, what do you mean change the way we do church? You don't change the way we do church. You do it God's way, is that correct? Careful, and how many churches? Have become so lukewarm. He wrote in his book, quote, from his book, newest one, the Bible says, quote, in his book, there's 15 Bible translations in his book. 15. I asked a group of teenagers one time, why would anybody put 15 Bible translations in a book? First hand went up, young man. I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Because you're trying to find something that fits what you want to say." Oh my goodness, the teenage boys got it all figured out. Let me tell you something, I don't need to find something that fits what I want to say. I need to fit what God says. It's my job to fit his book, not find something that fits my opinion. In his book, he wrote, quote, the Bible says, one of these modern translations, he, God, rules everything and is everywhere and is in everything. He, God, rules everything, is everywhere and is in everything. God is in everything. What is that worldview called, folks? That's called pantheism. That's called panentheism, okay? A completely different worldview than you folks have, but yet we've just read this book over and over. God, our church is going through this book, and yet it teaches something biblically different. Let me tell you something. Be careful in the days to come. In one of my other talks, I warn people all the time, be very careful of people with microphones. And I'm telling you, watch out for me. Because you have no clue if I speak untruth unless you know the what? Truth. Where do you find it at? You got it here. Filter every speaker, every book back through this. If it agrees with it, keep listening. If it doesn't agree, get as far away as you can from that person. Okay? I'm doing a big conference in a couple months with this guy who's written a book that's real big with the yuppie crowd and stuff, okay? And so I read part of his book. I opened up the front, looked at his Bible translation. His Bible translation was what? Nothing. He had no verses in the entire book. That means it was the word of who? Him. And yet it's one of the most popular books in Christianity today. He wrote in that book, quote, for me, the beginning of sharing my faith with people began by throwing out Christianity. This is a quote from this book, okay? And embracing Christian spirituality, a non-political, mysterious system that can be experienced but not explained. Excuse me, you can't explain Christianity. That's what God's word does. I can explain Christianity when I witness. Is that correct? That's what we're supposed to be doing, okay? That is fabrication. That's a lie of the biggest thing at the end of days. Be careful. Title of books, Your Best Life Now. My best life now, I don't want my best life here. I want my best life there. Paul said, for me to live is Christ and to die is what? Gain. Gain. I was at Mall of America witnessing yesterday, 30-minute conversations with these four teenagers. One boy had no money for food, so I already witnessed to him. I put a $20 bill on the table. I said, if you could have $20 or know exactly what it takes to go to heaven, I said, which one would you take? And that 17-year-old boy, Kyle, sat there and was thinking, and he said, I want the information it takes to go to heaven. I said, well, today's your lucky day. I said, you're going to get both of them. Okay? Because see, what I do is I take this money and I give it away. I give it to other people. I just keep giving ministry of money away. Why? Why not? That's what it's for. Is that correct? It's not for me. I don't need an IRA account. What are you going to do when you have all this money and you stand in front of the Lord Jesus Christ on Judgment Day? And it was for Bibles, for China, for missionaries. It was for gospel tracts. What are you going to do with that? You don't get a do-over. You don't get a mulligan. You don't get a second chance. You got one shot at this life to do it exactly the way that God, the Lord God, wants you to do it. Is that correct? That's correct. Are you meandering? Are you close to the 4, 5, and 6? Or are you pushing on through that? Quote from that exact same book. Quote, be the best you can be. Then you can feel good about yourself. Be the best you can be, and then you can feel good about yourself. Excuse me, what if your best is just 100 sins a day? What if that's your best? You need one word of advice, and that's called repent. That's what you need to hear. Okay, that's a lie. That is deception of the highest regard. Be very careful. But yet the Lord's not done yet. Go to verse 17, Revelation 3, verse 17. Because thou sayest, see, their opinion. Be careful if your opinion does not line up with God's opinion. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. Did you hear that? Have need of nothing. And knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. Need of nothing, self-delusion. Wait a minute, my Bible says your righteous acts are like what? Filthy rags. How can you be that self-deluded? I have need of nothing. I have need of a Savior. And follow and let him mold me into the man he wants me to be. That's what I need in the days to come. Need of nothing is called pride. They're stuck in a closed system. I don't need anything around me. It's just here. I'm okay. Excuse me. If you put a glass of cold tea on your tabletop when you're at a restaurant and it just sits there after a while, what temperature does it become? Lukewarm. You must take cold tea from outside and put on outside to keep it cold. If you have a hot cup of coffee in the morning, okay, and it just sits there, what temperatures have become? Lukewarm. You must put the hot coffee in there to make that happen. What's John 15 says? You can do nothing without me, Jesus says. You can do nothing. I can't even breathe today. Daniel 5 says God holds your breath in the palm of his hand. That means at any moment he can snatch it away, but if he's allowed you to have it today, would you take it and glorify the Lord? Would you let your lips glorify the Lord Jesus Christ in someone's life? Would you do that? Because he allowed you to have breath today. But one day he shall snatch it away, okay? Jesus said, you were poor. But they said, we're wealthy, they said. He says, you're blind. He said, but wait a minute, you can't see. They said, well, they were known for the eye salve, to make the eyes people physically see better, okay? He said, you're naked. They were known for the clothing industry. They had this black clothing. People come from all over to buy this clothing that they had there because it's beautiful wool-type clothing, okay? Think about that. Watch where we go. Go to verse 18. I counsel thee. Excuse me. If the Lord's going to give you some counsel, would you want to pay attention? I want to pay attention at this point, okay? I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich with white raiment, and thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness does not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou may seest, okay? Heed the advice of the Son of God. He's given you counsel, gold tried by fire. See, there was fire today at the restaurant I just ate at. That's okay. I came out of that stronger today, okay? Because if that's the best Satan has for me today, trust me, that ain't gonna stop me. Hey, no possible way, okay? You got to come better than that, I hope, okay? But see, you get tried by fire where you stay passionate and bold like that, okay? I love to witness at Christmas time because just go to the malls and go witnessing because sinners love buying gifts, so I go visit them at the malls, and so I just chat with them and stuff. In Atlanta, we have 18 major malls in Atlanta. So I try to hit all the malls during the Christmas season. We have a small shopping problem back home. And so I just go to the malls and hang out. And when I'm in malls at Christmas, I was paying attention last Christmas in one very wealthy mall. I tried to see what was the busiest store, and the busiest store was Tiffany's. You know, in Tiffany's, where you can't buy nothing under about like $5,000, there was a line of people buying this stuff that will never make it past the grave. The next mall I went to, it was the Apple store. People all lined up, walked out the store because they want to get in there and buy their what? Got to get that iPod, got to get that iMac, okay? Just got to have that, okay? But wait a minute, it's not going to matter when it's said and done. As I'm spending money on things that doesn't matter when I could take my money and support one of those compassion children right there. What you gonna do when you have a lot of stuff that won't even come to your funeral, let alone make it past the grave when we had all these children we could have supported and stuff like that. For a family, I just bought them a child from Liberia. I'm now into child trafficking right now. I think it's illegal, and so I think I'm in trouble. But they were adopting kids. I just decided I want to take ministry money and buy them a kid. You know what these kids in this family already do on their birthdays? They ask their dad to take them witnessing on their birthdays. This is what the children already do. See, I wasn't getting a kid to come into this family. I was getting a kid come into this family so they're going to train up warriors for Jesus Christ. There's just four more warriors coming up from Liberia that this family will train up and send out into this world. Okay, see, what's your mindset? I couldn't spend money better than that in my life. White raiment, okay, but they were known for the black wool, okay? See, Jesus wants you to see spiritually. Bono, the lead singer of U2, he's been on some of your Christian magazines, on your covers. Piped into some of the big conferences. Bono very recently at a concert, he wears a headband. It shows up on the side screens. And the headband says coexist, C-O-E-X-I-S-T. And in the coexist, the C on the coexist is the crescent moon of Islam. The X in coexist is the Star of David for Judaism. The T in coexist is the cross of Lord Jesus Christ for Christianity. And he goes, Jesus, Jew, Muhammad, all true. Jesus, Jew, Muhammad, all true. Some countries going, it's true. Anyone see a small problem with that by any chance, okay? He's trying to say that they're all what? Equal. Is that a true statement? Excuse me, this is the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, the sinless Savior. As Brandon talked about what Erwin Lutzer at that conference, he is the only one that died on the cross and rose from the dead 3 days later. You have the only right answer. Okay? But will you give the right answer, Lord Jesus Christ? Or are you going to selfishly keep him to yourself as you're meandering around the 4, 5, and 6? Think about that for a second, okay? Think. I just read an article on the internet. This guy said, you know, if you're ever on a plane flight, okay, make sure you don't share your faith with the person next to you, okay? Because it's going to make them uncomfortable. Excuse me, okay? This gentleman got so many emails back to this website where he wrote this article at, okay, that he wrote another article. Well, I really didn't mean don't show your share your faith with the person next to you on the plane flight. Excuse me, that's exactly what you meant until everybody called you on it. Okay, now you want to change your opinion, okay? See, that's your conscience telling you, I need to chat with that person. Nod your head. You ever had your conscience tell you, I need to talk to that person about the Lord? Nod your head. Yeah, all the time. But will you obey the Lord or listen to terrible advice like that? I fly all the time. I pray for the person next to me on plane flights. I've already prayed. I will pray tonight for the two people I have on the two flights as I head to Buffalo, New York tomorrow, okay, to see who God's going to put there. I can't wait to find out. Because all I have to do is ask a few questions. And if I find out you're a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, I'm about to encourage you to be the most radically bold, sold-out Christians ever lived on planet Earth. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, you're about to get the best piece of information you've ever had in your entire life. See, but that's what we have to be about, that business. I was in the Atlanta airport, and I started chatting with this guy. I just had a real quick conversation. It was his birthday, and he had a little five-year-old kid that wanted to go to the restroom. So I took my book, One Heartbeat Away, signed it, gave it to him. I said, hey, enjoy that. Have a birthday. And bingo. So he's gone. Well, I get on my flight, and this gentleman, Greg, was on this flight, the guy I just gave the book to. So I'm walking on the flight, and he taps and Mark. I said, what? I was sitting back behind him. He said, don't forget. He said, 10 out of 10 people die. And I wrote right up in the front of the book, don't forget, 10 out of 10 people die. 100% chance you're walking out of here, correct? Correct. Question is, where are you going? So I went back, sat in my seat, and there's a gentleman next to me, and I said, hey, how you doing? That's a good way to start with anybody. Hey, how you doing, right? Where are you from? What do you do? Why are you traveling here? Just talk with people, right? Very simple statement. Witnessing is not a presentation. Witnessing is a conversation. Very simple statement. Witnessing is not a presentation. Witnessing is a conversation. Jesus talked with the woman at the well. Conversation. Jesus talked with the rich young ruler. Conversation, okay? Had a conversation. So I started talking with this guy, and his name was Eric. I said, Eric, I said, where are you from? He said he lives in Florida now. I said, you got a good accent, though. He said, yeah, that's New York. I said, okay. I said, were you in New York City on September 11th? He said, you better believe I was. I was working two buildings down when all that began to happen. I said, how did that impact your life? He said, well, I went home that day to my wife, said, honey, let's get out of here. And so I said, okay. I said, where'd you move to? He said, Bay St. Louis, Mississippi. And we've all heard of Katrina, correct? And I looked at Eric. I said, what'd you lose? He said, everything. I said, you mean everything? He said, no, I mean everything. He said, matter of fact, I went back to visit, and I went back to where my house was, and my house was gone, and my cars were gone. Everything was literally gone. And he said, Mark, it was very interesting, because what I noticed was everything man-made was gone, but everything nature made was still there. The birds, the trees, the bushes, okay, was all, so everything man-made, gone, everything nature made, still there. I said, no, Eric, not everything nature made, everything what? God made. I said, do you believe in God? He said, well, he said, you know, I'm Jewish, and he just was kind of more agnostic, so we start talking and stuff like that. I said, what do you think happens when you die? I said, oh, there's just a heaven. Is that a true statement? It's not a true statement. I said, that's actually not what Judaism teaches. Judaism teaches heaven or hell. So I reached above me, I pulled my Bible out, and it was this one right here, and I pulled it out to show him some Jewish scriptures. He said, excuse me. I said, what? He said, since that's your Bible, shouldn't it be a lot more well-worn than it is right now? Oh, my goodness. It was like a dagger in the heart when that Jewish man said that, because he knows if you believe this to be true, you should be ripping this book up, knowing this book, living what this book says. I had just bought this Bible because I wanted a smaller one for travel, but this guy, he challenged me on that plane flight, and I appreciated what he had to say. Pulled the scriptures out, showed him Psalm 139, if you ascend into heaven, O God, you are there. If I descend into the depths, O God, you are there too. How many places? Two places. Daniel chapter 12, you be raised to everlasting righteousness or everlasting contempt. How many places? Two places, okay? I said, what do you think separates the two places? Walked him through the Ten Commandments, walked him through animal sacrifice, walked him through the sacrifice, Lord Jesus Christ, okay? End up signing the book, giving him the book. I get off the plane, all right? The guy up front, Greg, the lawyer, he's waiting for me when I get off the plane, okay? I get off the plane, he points at me, he says, come here. I said, okay. I said, what can I do for you? He said, Mark, I'm a lawyer. I didn't know this at this point. He said, I'm a lawyer. I thought I was in trouble. And I said, I'm a lawyer. He said, Mark, a lawyer knows one thing. I said, what is that? A lawyer knows you need good evidence to prove your case. Lawyers won't take certain cases because it doesn't have the evidence, okay? He said, Mark, I absolutely love the evidence in this book, all right? Next day, I'm flying out of Omaha again. Guess who's on my flight? Eric, my Jewish guy, okay? He comes walking up, he's on his cell phone, he says, somebody said, excuse me, I'll be back, and he walks directly over to me in his full suit at this time, reaches over to shake my hand. Okay? He said, Mark, he said, man, it was so good meeting you yesterday, and I just have total respect for what you, and I just want to come up and say thank you again for the conversation that we had yesterday. Isn't it nice to know we're not supposed to witness the people next to us on airplane flights, okay? I mean, just think about that terrible advice that that guy gave to people, because people are hungry for truth. Is that not right? That is right. So that's what we did. We actually wrote a book called One Heartbeat Away. And what happened on the last heartbeat? Is it nothing? Is it reincarnation? Is it heaven or hell? I wanted to find out, okay? So that's what we did. We did things as simple as, could you prove there was a God? I grew up Catholic. I was taught it. Could you prove it? Wanted to know. Could you prove any religious text true? Okay? I wanted to find out, could you prove the Bible true? Could you prove the Book of Mormon? Could you prove any of this true? Guess what? I was over doing a radio show today, and two Mormon missionaries come up to me on bicycles as I'm standing there ready to go into Subway. Okay? I said, hey, how you guys doing? They said, good. How you doing? I said, good. So we started talking. And Before they walked away, both Mormon missionaries had this book, okay? And I told my emails in the book, I said, please email me, tell me what you think about it. They said, we will do that. See, I'm gonna show them how the Bible and the Bible only is the true book. Then we go through a chapter called The Flames. All these near-death experiences. You know how people see flatline and see white lights and tunnels? But yet, I've met 9 or 10 different people who got the opposite. I had a friend flatlined, end of his saw a lake of fire he could feel the heat from. Nurses told me they had patients scream the flames, flatline and die. Met a nurse the other day, she had a patient, all of a sudden it was right towards the end, their eyes opened huge, they started screaming, but nothing came out, just the wide mouth, flatline and die. She told me she knew that man had to see a demon, had to see the devil or something, because he was so scared at the end. I've met 9 or 10 different people who got hell, not heaven, a bunch of the stories in there, but what separates one or the other? We walk you right through the Ten Commandments. My older brother Mike, I just picked him up from the airport, and my older brother Mike's not born again and saved, and he just read this book. He said, Mark, I read that chapter on the Ten Commandments, and I knew without a doubt at that moment I was dying and going to hell. I said, Mike, aren't you glad I didn't stop the book at that point? He said, oh, I'm glad you didn't stop the book at that point, okay, because we walk you right to the cross. Ready for this? We've had atheists read this book, become born again. Agnostics read this book, become born again. Catholics read this book, become born again. Muslims read this book, become born again. Prisoners read this book, become born again. Those are just the ones we've heard of. Nod your head if you have lost people you're trying to reach in life. Nod your head, okay? You got a tool you can drop in their hands, okay? Because I'm telling you, lost people are reading this book, and it's unbelievable, but it's full of stories. I love to witness, as you can already tell. In this book, I got to witness to, remember Vanilla Ice Baby? Okay, remember him, okay? We had a 30-minute conversation in the Fort Lauderdale Airport. Super nice guy, but one thing I'll never forget about him, I said, hey, what are you into? He said, well, I'm into Scientology. I said, okay. I said, how'd you get into Scientology? I'll never forget his answer to the day I die. And he said, because John Travolta had a talk with me. What was John Travolta doing? Witnessing and sharing his faith, okay? Think about that. As we're concerned about our next musical at our church, who's gonna win the baseball game tonight? Where are we going this weekend afterwards? And John Travolta's just out there sharing lies with people. And we have the truth, but because most of us wind up in a lukewarm category, we don't share it with people. At the end of the book, I wrote towards the end, I said, if you're born again by this point, I said, remember this statement, okay? When you die, make sure John Travolta has not outwitnessed you. True statement? Some of us in the room have a long way to go because he's sharing his faith pretty boldly. Think about that, okay? I got a chance to witness to Magic Johnson's in this book, Terrell Owens, the football player's in this book, the one everybody loves. I got a chance to go one-on-one with Tiger Woods in Orlando, Florida. We were on a golf course, we were walking. I said, Tiger, always wanted to ask you a question. He said, go for it. I said, Tiger, I said, when you die, I said, what do you think's on the other side? What do you think's out there when you walk out of here? Tiger Woods literally stopped dead square in his tracks, stared up at me and said, I don't know. And we began a 10-minute conversation, the whole story's in here, okay? Within 1 week, 3 different people who heard about the story got to finish where I got stuck at the very next week, okay? Don't we serve a wonderful God? See, some plant, some water, but it's only God who gives the increase. But are you planting that he can take that and let it go from there? 4 weeks ago, got an email from Baghdad. A soldier read this book in Baghdad. He said, Mark, I just read this book. It has completely impacted my life and changed my life. He said, I work with 300 soldiers here. He said, how do I get 300 copies of this? I said, what's your address? So he sends me his APO address. I sent him 300 copies. Last week, he sends me pictures from Baghdad of all these soldiers in a meeting. They were holding the book up. He took pictures and sent it to me here in the States, okay? Because these soldiers understand one heartbeat away. See, it's us folk who don't understand it until September 11th. Until we're at a funeral and we see a casket right here and we have no clue where that person is at right now. See, we see the physical body left, but where's the soul and the spirit right now? What you gonna do about that, okay? We had one gentleman last year, the book has been out just 1 year. He read this book in one sitting, called me up and said, Mark, I work with a ministry. We're putting together a duffel bag for all these teenagers that are coming back to Gulfport, Biloxi, and New Orleans for Christmas. Mark, I want to put one of these books in every single teenager's hand and every single parent's hand. He said, Mark, how do I get 5,000 of these? We got him 5,000 and literally started going into all these hands back in the Gulf Coast region. Okay, think about that. We've had churches get these and put them in the visitor packets. I've gotten emails from visitors at churches who got this in a visitor packet, okay? It explained the whole gospel to them, and they emailed and wanted to tell what happened with them as they read that book, okay? See, ideas. We've had people get this book for every single family member in the holidays. We have employers buying for every employee in their place, okay? We have one gentleman who runs eye care clinics. He bought 1,500 books. He said, Mark, I'm putting these in all my eye care clinics, okay? Individual rooms, main waiting room, because I am not gonna work on these people's eyes so they can see physically and they cannot see spiritually, no way. They're gonna see both ways, okay? He just went through 1,500 books, just ordered 1,000 more. This gentleman is literally trying to reach all his patients and everybody out for the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? When you walk out, there's a compassion table. I have a little small table next to it with nothing on it but a table and no doilies and no tablecloths, okay? That's how I operate. There's books there for you, okay? I dare to be different. There's no price tag on these books. I put price tags on nothing. You go to my website, there's no price tags on my website. It's donational. Whatever you feel led by the Lord to give is what you give, okay? This one's in the stores. It's $15. If you want to give $15, great. If you don't have that and you want to give less, fine with me, okay? If you want to give more to help me do what I do around the country, great. If you don't have the money, you can take it. There's an address. You can send it in later. I go this far. If you pay your tithes and pay your bills, is that the correct order? God's money's first. Okay, mine's always second, okay? If you pay your tithes and pay your bills and you do not have any extra money, okay, and you're tight on money, do some families fall in that category? Yep, some teenagers fall in that category. If there's a financial reason and you don't have the money for this and you want it, you can walk back there and take it for free. It's on me. I'll give it to you. Only stipulation is you have to read it or you have to put it into a lost person's hand after you've chatted with them, okay? Why would I do that? One, I'm a little bit crazy, okay? Two, the other reason is, can you put a price tag on a soul? Give it your best shot. You can't. And if you could, it was paid for 2,000 years ago. You can't put a price tag on a soul, okay? That's why we keep doing it for donation only. We get people who will take cases and pay nothing. We have people get one book and pay $1,000. I don't care. All I pray for is that we have enough money every time we reprint it and to ship it out and every time we've done it. Do we have the money? Of course we do. I serve a great big God that parts Red Seas, okay? Also, if you're not born again, this is my book to you. It's free for you. You walk out, just take it free off the table. It's my gift to you for coming, okay, if you're not born again and saved, okay? So when you walk out, when I finish in just a second, one to a person, and if there's any extra, you can start getting extra ones tomorrow for that. I just want to make sure everybody can get one if you want one. And also, you can get multiples at the website, or you can get them at the bookstores and stuff like that, okay? Now watch this as we bring this to a close, all right? Go to verse 19. After all this, after all he just said, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. Verse 19, as many as I love. Did you hear? As many as I love. After all this, you still love us? What is it? This is an unconditional love that we don't understand. Is that right? Come on, you just said you're going to spew me. Nah, as many as I love. Watch what he says. All right? I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and what? Repent. Come, change your mind, change your ways. If you're a 4, 5, and 6, today is the day to repent of that sin. At this altar afterwards, by your bed back at the hotel, I don't care where. If you're living a lukewarm, nasty lifestyle, today is the day to get back on track. He still loves you. 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice, and open up the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me, eat with him and he with me. Have you heard that verse before? It's used numerous times during salvation messages, is that correct? It has nothing to do with salvation, nothing. He is talking to the lukewarm church. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice. Let me ask you a question, youth groups. If Jesus was knocking at the door, could you hear him? With all your rock music going on, could you hear him? With your iPod thing stuck in your ears, could you hear him if he was knocking? Playing all your video games at your churches, could you hear the Lord if he was knocking? As pizza, yo-yos, and Six Flags are killing the kids today. Killing the kids today. I know a youth pastor in Chicago, he took over a youth group in Chicago, had 12 kids in it. First year, he grew it to 4. 12, he grew it to 4 the first year. Got rid of all the pizza, all the yo-yos, all the six-pack, got all the games, ditched it. Got their Bibles out, started reading, started praying, started worshiping, started working at homeless shelters, started street witnessing. 3 years later, running 1,500 youth. He used to take his youth in school buses, load them up around Chicago, drop them off at strip clubs in Chicago. And if your parents want to send your kids to this youth group by any chance, drop them off at strip clubs in Chicago. The kids would get off the buses, circle the strip clubs in a circle of prayer, and begin to pray the strip clubs out of Chicago. He told me 6 of them closed down. One closed within 24 hours after his youth showed up. Let me tell you something. When you see God move like that, there is no scream machine. There is no roller coaster. There is no Mall of America that can even begin to compare to that. Is that correct? That is correct. What God are you serving? I'm serving a God that parts Red Seas, parts big Red Seas that people can walk across on dry land. That's even another big miracle if you think about it, okay? But that's the God that I serve. Will you serve the same God? Would you move from the 4, 5, and 6 and walk over to the 8, 9, and 10? That's where you belong as a servant of the Most High God, okay? Think about that. But if, watch what he says, if any man, here's the point, that's why it was the church of the Laodiceans. This is an individual call. He's not calling your youth group to repent. He is not calling your church to repent. He's calling who? You. He's calling the person you see in the mirror every single day. Would you repent today? Would you repent tonight? First time I ever gave this talk, 4,500 teenagers, youth leaders, and all, I started getting these emails from youth leaders repenting of this mediocre, disgusting Christianity they were teaching their kids, and they're on fire for the Lord, just going out there and reaching lost people for Jesus Christ. Young people have been caught up, more concerned about their GPAs and boyfriends and girlfriends and jobs. I said, forget that. I am going to serve the Lord Jesus Christ with all that I've got. It's an individual call. He's knocking. Can you hear him? Or something else got your attention? Judgment day comes. Judgment day sorts everything out, is that correct? Sorts everything out. Let me tell you something, you might have some people call you a little bit crazy, a little bit Jesus freak, okay? A little bit radical, okay? Judgment day sorts it all out, is that right? I'm much more concerned what Jesus says on that day. John 12, do you seek the praises of men or do you seek the praises of God? We all want to hear, well done and good and faithful servant, but are you living a radical, bold, biblical, obedient life that you could actually hear, well done, my good and faithful servant? Think about that, okay? 21, we'll close it for you. To him that overcometh, will I grant to sit with me on my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father on his throne. To he that overcometh, you have the power through Jesus Christ to overcome that sin, is that correct? You have the power by Jesus Christ to overcome those temptations, that lukewarmness. Will you overcome by his power to sit on his throne? Let me tell you something. If there's a throne to sit on, it would be his throne, is that correct? Because I could just see somebody sitting there, right there, and there's the Lord just got an arm around him. So let me tell you about this person. Remember this statement, some of the most famous people you'll ever meet in heaven, some of the wealthiest people you'll ever meet in heaven, you'll have never met or heard about down here. It'll be that faithful grandmother praying all the time for those kids and taking control of her street back in a tough neighborhood and sharing Jesus Christ with those kids. You've never heard her name. She'll be famous in heaven. I know a lady, her whole goal is to reach her entire street for Lord Jesus Christ. She prays for every single house on the street, has met everybody on the street, verbally witnesses to the people, found out the birthday of everybody, bakes cakes, cookies, and pies for the people on their birthdays and stuff. She's seen 2 entire households repent of their sins and come born again, plugged into her very solid Baptist church. And her goal is all the rest of those houses. That's a lady you'll hear about in heaven one day, okay? Don't think it's all that to be up here with a microphone. Don't think it's all that, okay? I'd rather be a faithful servant of the Most High God, dying and Jesus Christ saying, well done, my good and faithful servant. You read your Bible. You obeyed what you read. And now enter into reward and come, please, please. Think about that. Please sit with me on my throne, because I think it's going to be just as much of a joy for Jesus that you're there, that it'll be a joy for you. Interesting to think about, okay? 22 as we close. He that hath an ear, Let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Did you listen tonight? Not to the speaker. Did you listen to God's word tonight? How do you look at life? Is it a battleground or is it a playground? I don't go to the Mall of America for a playground. Oh, there's one in there. Big one, too. Okay? I go there because it's a battleground for lost people to chat with about the Lord Jesus Christ. Met some Christian kids in there going to ministry college. Witnessed to them, gave them a book to encourage them on their faith, gave them tracts. I said, young men, let's pray. I prayed for them. I said, now turn around and walk into this mall, okay, and start talking with people. Is that right? That's what we're here for, is to do that, okay? The question is, will you do that? Either lose yourself in the world of Jesus, deny yourself and take up your cross, or deny Jesus and put down the cross. It's your choice, okay? If Jesus is real, you should be all for him. If not, you should be all against him. That's why when I meet lost people that have a hatred for Jesus, it doesn't bother me all that much. At least they're standing up for what they believe, right? It's really true, okay? See, you're either all against him or you're all for him. You can't hang out in 4, 5, and 6. He will spew you out of his mouth. Today is a day. Would you repent? Would you come to the cross of Jesus Christ? Would you leave any nasty sin that's holding you back from being radical? Last question. Can you guarantee me you're going to wake up tomorrow morning? No. I ask it to lost people all the time, and I always tell them the Bible says today's the day of salvation. Don't put your head on your pillow tonight, okay? Don't put your head on your pillow tonight. You know exactly where you're going to spend eternity. I ask you, Christians, can you guarantee me you're going to wake up tomorrow morning? Don't you dare stand before the throne of God, and you won't be standing. You'll be face down. When unholiness sees holiness, you go face down, folks. And it makes you very thankful for a cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? When you die and stand on Judgment Day, a very simple statement, die with no regrets. Die with no regrets. You don't get a second chance at this life. You don't get a mulligan. You don't get a do-over. You got one shot at this life. Is that right? That's right. Give it all you got. Leave all the energy expended on the battleground of earth, okay? And walk out of here as a holy, righteous servant of the Lord, that you've lived a life where you could actually hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. Father, we thank you so much for just a wonderful chance to be here, Father God. Father, by the power of your Holy Spirit, whatever is going on in anybody's life, whatever is going on in their life, Father God, that's keeping them in the 4, 5, and 6 category, if it's a relationship, if it's a degree they're just so hungry for, if it's a sport, if it's an idol worship of some athlete or some rock star, Father, convict it by the power of your Holy Spirit. Father, let them know that it is vomit to you, it is nasty, it's making them sick, it's sick to your stomach, Father God, and it should make our stomach sick as you're trying to drive us to holiness and purity and righteousness. Father God, if that sin needs to repent of tonight, let them repent before they even walk out of here, back at their hotel. Father, remind them it's an individual call. Whether one of their friends ever gets serious about it, they own a mirror. They must look in the mirror. Is this young man, is this mom, is this dad, is this young lady radically sold out for you? Father God, get some people to repent and mold them into warriors for you in the days to come. People will be hearing about for all of eternity in a place called heaven because of the righteous life, the bold life they live for you. And so, Father, we thank you for that, and we do. And we ask it in the great name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen, okay? All right, now, all eyes up here. Spiritually, Bono, the lead singer of U2, he's been on some of your Christian magazines, on your covers, piped into some of the big conferences. Bono very recently at a concert, he wears a headband. It shows up on the side screens. And the headband says coexist, C-O-E-X-I-S-T. And in the coexist, the sea on the coexist is the crescent moon of Islam. The X in coexist is the Star of David for Judaism. The T in coexist is the cross of Lord Jesus Christ for Christianity. And he goes, Jesus, Jew, Muhammad, all true. Jesus, Jew, Muhammad, all true. Some conscience is going, it's true. Anyone see a small problem with that by any chance, okay? He's trying to say that they're all what? Equal. Is that a true statement? Excuse me, this is the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, the sinless Savior. As Brandon talked about with Erwin Lutzer at that conference, he is the only one that died on the cross and rose from the dead 3 days later. You have the only right answer, okay? But will you give the right answer, Lord Jesus Christ, or are you gonna selfishly keep him to yourself as you're meandering around the 4, 5, and 6? Think about that for a second, okay? Think. I just read an article on the internet. This guy said, you know, if you're ever on a plane flight, okay, make sure you don't share your faith with the person next to you, okay? Because it's gonna make them uncomfortable. Excuse me, okay? This gentleman got so many emails back to this website where he wrote this article at, okay, that he wrote another article. Well, I really didn't mean don't show your share your faith with the person next to you on the plane flight. Excuse me, that's exactly what you meant until everybody called you on it. Okay, now you want to change your opinion, okay? See, that's your conscience telling you, I need to chat with that person. Nod your head. You ever had your conscience tell you, I need to talk to that person about the Lord? Nod your head. Yeah, all the time. But will you obey the Lord or listen to terrible advice like that? I fly all the time. I pray for the person next to me on plane flights. I've already prayed. I will pray tonight for the two people I'll have on the two flights as I head to Buffalo, New York tomorrow, okay, to see who God's going to put there. I can't wait to find out. Because all I have to do is ask a few questions. And if I find out you're a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, I'm about to encourage you to be the most radically bold, sold-out Christians ever lived on planet Earth. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, you're about to get the best piece of information you've ever had in your entire life. See, but that's what we have to be about, that business. I was in the Atlanta airport, and I started chatting with this guy. I just had a real quick conversation. It was his birthday, and he had a little five-year-old kid that wanted to go to the restroom, so I took my book, One Heartbeat Away, signed it, gave it to him. I said, hey, enjoy that, have a birthday, and bingo. So he's gone. Well, I get on my flight, and this gentleman, Greg, was on this flight, the guy I just gave the book to. So I'm walking on the flight, and he taps, said, Mark. I said, what? I was sitting back behind him. He said, don't forget. He said, 10 out of 10 people die. And I wrote right up in the front of the book, don't forget, 10 out of 10 people die. 100% chance you're walking out of here, correct? Correct. Question is, where are you going? So I went back, sat in my seat, and there's a gentleman next to me, and I said, hey, how you doing? That's a good way to start with anybody. Hey, how you doing, right? Where are you from? What do you do? Why are you traveling here? Just talk with people, right? Very simple statement, witnessing is not a presentation, witnessing is a conversation. Very simple statement. Witnessing is not a presentation, witnessing is a conversation. Jesus talked with the woman at the well, conversation. Jesus talked with the rich young ruler, conversation, okay? Had a conversation. So I started talking to this guy, and his name was Eric. I said, Eric, I said, where are you from? He said he lives in Florida now. I said, you got a good accent though. He said, yeah, that's New York. I said, okay. I said, were you in New York City on September 11th? He said, you better believe I was. I was working two buildings down when all that began to happen. I said, how did that impact your life? He said, well, I went home that day to my wife, said, honey, let's get out of here. And so I said, okay. I said, where'd you move to? He said, Bay St. Louis, Mississippi. And we've all heard of Katrina, correct? And I looked at Eric. I said, what'd you lose? He said, everything. I said, you mean everything? He said, no, I mean everything. He said, matter of fact, I went back to visit, and I went back to where my house was, and my house was gone, and my cars were gone. Everything was literally gone. And he said, Mark, it was very interesting, because what I noticed was everything man-made was gone, but everything nature made was still there. The birds, the trees, the bushes, okay, was all, so everything man-made, gone, everything nature made, still there. I said, no, Eric, not everything nature made, everything what? God made. I said, do you believe in God? He said, well, he said, you know, I'm Jewish, and so, you know, he just was kind of more agnostic, so we start talking and stuff like that. I said, what do you think happens when you die? I said, oh, there's just a heaven. Is that a true statement? It's not a true statement. I said, that's actually not what Judaism teaches. Judaism teaches heaven or hell. So I reached above me, I pulled my Bible out, and it was this one right here, and I pulled it out to show him some Jewish scriptures. He said, excuse me. I said, what? He said, since that's your Bible, shouldn't it be a lot more well-worn than it is right now? Oh, my goodness. It was like a dagger in the heart when that Jewish man said that, because he knows if you believe this to be true, you should be ripping this book up, knowing this book, living what this book says. I had just bought this Bible because I wanted a smaller one for travel, but this guy, he challenged me on that plane flight, and I appreciated what he had to say. Pulled the scriptures out, showed him Psalm 139, if you ascend into heaven, O God, you are there. If I descend into the depths, O God, you are there too. How many places? Two places. Daniel chapter 12, you be raised to everlasting righteousness or everlasting contempt. How many places? Two places, okay? I said, what do you think separates the two places? Walked him through the Ten Commandments, walked him through animal sacrifice, walked him through the sacrifice, Lord Jesus Christ, okay? End up signing the book, giving him the book. I get off the plane, all right? The guy up front, Greg, the lawyer, he's waiting for me when I get off the plane, okay? I get off the plane, he points at me, he says, come here. I said, okay. I said, what can I do for you? He said, Mark, I'm a lawyer. I didn't know this at this point. He said, I'm a lawyer. I thought I was in trouble. And I said, I'm a lawyer. He said, Mark, a lawyer knows one thing. I said, what is that? A lawyer knows you need good evidence to prove your case. Lawyers won't take certain cases because it doesn't have the evidence, okay? He said, Mark, I absolutely love the evidence in this book, all right? Next day, I'm flying out of Omaha again. Guess who's on my flight? Eric, my Jewish guy, okay? He comes walking up, he's on his cell phone, he says, somebody said, excuse me, I'll be back, and he walks directly over to me in his full suit at this time, reaches over to shake my hand. Okay? He said, Mark, he said, man, it was so good meeting you yesterday, and I just have total respect for what you do. I just want to come up and say thank you again for the conversation that we had yesterday. Isn't it nice to know we're not supposed to witness the people next to us on airplane flights? Okay? I mean, just think about that terrible advice that that guy gave to people, because people are hungry for truth. Is that not right? That is right. So that's what we did. We actually wrote a book called One Heartbeat Away. And what happened on the last heartbeat? Is it nothing? Is it reincarnation? Is it heaven or hell? I wanted to find out, okay? So that's what we did. We did things as simple as, could you prove there was a God? I grew up Catholic. I was taught it. Could you prove it? Wanted to know. Could you prove any religious text true? Okay? I wanted to find out, could you prove the Bible true? Could you prove the Book of Mormon? Could you prove any of this true? Guess what? I was over doing a radio show today, and two Mormon missionaries come up to me on bicycles as I'm standing there ready to go into Subway. Okay? I said, hey, how you guys doing? They said, good. How you doing? I said, good. So we started talking. And before they walked away, both Mormon missionaries had this book. Okay, and I told my emails in the book, I said, please email me, tell me what you think about it. They said, we will do that. See, I'm going to show them how the Bible and the Bible only is the true book. Then we go through a chapter called The Flames, all these near-death experience stories. You know how people see flatline and see white lights in tunnels? But yet, I've met 9 or 10 different people who got the opposite. I had a friend flatlined, end of his saw a lake of fire he could feel the heat from. Nurses told me they had patients scream the flames, flatline and die. Met a nurse the other day, she had a patient, all of a sudden, it was right towards the end, their eyes opened huge, they started screaming, but nothing came out, just the wide mouth, flatline and die. She told me she knew that man had to see a demon, had to see the devil or something, because he was so scared at the end. I've met 9 or 10 different people who got hell, not heaven, a bunch of the stories in there, but what separates one or the other? We walk you right through the Ten Commandments. My older brother Mike, I just picked him up from the airport. And my older brother, Mike's not born again and saved, and he just read this book. He said, Mark, I read that chapter on the Ten Commandments, and I knew without a doubt at that moment I was dying and going to hell. I said, Mike, aren't you glad I didn't stop the book at that point? He said, oh, I'm glad you didn't stop the book at that point, okay? Because we walk you right to the cross. Ready for this? We've had atheists read this book, become born again. Agnostics read this book, become born again. Catholics read this book, become born again. Muslims read this book, become born again. Prisoners read this book, become born again. Those are just the ones we've heard of. Nod your head if you have lost people you're trying to reach in life. Nod your head, okay? You got a tool you can drop in their hands, okay? Because I'm telling you, lost people are reading this book, and it's unbelievable, but it's full of stories. I love to witness, as you can already tell. In this book, I got to witness to, remember Vanilla Ice? Ice Baby? Okay, remember him? Okay. We had a 30-minute conversation in the Fort Lauderdale Airport. Super nice guy, but one thing I'll never forget about him. I said, hey, what are you into? He said, well, I'm into Scientology. I said, okay. I said, how'd you get into Scientology? I'll never forget his answer to the day I die. And he said, because John Travolta had a talk with me. What was John Travolta doing? Witnessing and sharing his faith. Okay? Think about that. As we're concerned about our next musical at our church, Who's going to win the baseball game tonight? Where are we going this weekend afterwards? And John Travolta's just out there sharing lies with people. And we have the truth, but because most of us wind up in a lukewarm category, we don't share it with people. At the end of the book, I wrote towards the end, I said, if you're born again by this point, I said, remember this statement, okay? When you die, make sure John Travolta has not outwitnessed you. True statement. Some of us in the room have a long way to go because he's sharing his faith pretty boldly. Think about that, okay? I got a chance to witness to Magic Johnson's in this book, Terrell Owens, the football player's in this book, the one everybody loves. I got a chance to go one-on-one with Tiger Woods in Orlando, Florida. We were on a golf course. We were walking. I said, Tiger, always wanted to ask you a question. He said, go for it. I said, Tiger, I said, when you die, I said, what do you think's on the other side? What do you think's out there when you walk out of here? Tiger Woods literally stopped dead square in his tracks, stared up at me and said, I don't know. And we began a 10-minute conversation. The whole story's in here, okay? Within 1 week, three different people who heard about the story got to finish where I got stuck at the very next week, okay? Don't we serve a wonderful God? See, some plant, some water, but it's only God who gives the increase. But are you planting that he can take that and let it go from there? 4 weeks ago, got an email from Baghdad. A soldier read this book in Baghdad. He said, Mark, I just read this book. It has completely impacted my life and changed my life. He said, I work with 300 soldiers here. He said, how do I get 300 copies of this? I said, what's your address? So he sends me his APO address. I sent him 300 copies. Last week, he sends me pictures from Baghdad of all these soldiers in a meeting. They were holding the book up. He took pictures and sent it to me here in the States, okay? Because see, soldiers understand one heartbeat away. See, it's us folk who don't understand it until September 11th. Until we're at a funeral and we see a casket right here and we have no clue where that person is at right now. See, we see the physical body left, but where's the soul and the spirit right now? What you gonna do about that, okay? We had one gentleman last year. The book has been out just 1 year. He read this book in one sitting, called me up and said, Mark, I work with a ministry. We're putting together a duffel bag for all these teenagers that are coming back to Gulfport, Biloxi, and New Orleans for Christmas. Mark, I want to put one of these books in every single teenager's hand and every single parent's hand. He said, Mark, how do I get 5,000 of these? We got him 5,000 and literally started going into all these hands back in the Gulf Coast region. Okay, think about that. We've had churches get these and put them in the visitor packets. I've gotten emails from visitors at churches who got this in a visitor packet, okay? It explained the whole gospel to them, and they emailed and wanted to tell what happened with them as they read that book, okay? See, ideas. We've had people get this book for every single family member in the holidays. We have employers buying for every employee in their place, okay? We have one gentleman who runs eye care clinics. He bought 1,500 books. He said, Mark, I'm putting these in all my eye care clinics, okay? Individual rooms, main waiting room, because I am not going to work on these people's eyes so they can see physically and they cannot see spiritually. No way. They're going to see both ways, okay? He just went through 1,500 books, just ordered 1,000 more. This gentleman is literally trying to reach all his patients and everybody out for the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? When you walk out, there's a compassion table. I have a little small table next to it with nothing on it but a table and no doilies and no tablecloths, okay? That's how I operate. There's books there for you, okay? I dare to be different. There's no price tag on these books. I put price tags on nothing. You go to my website, there's no price tags on my website. It's donational. Whatever you feel led by the Lord to give is what you give, okay? This one's in the stores. It's $15. If you want to give $15, great. If you don't have that and you want to give less, fine with me, okay? If you want to give more to help me do what I do around the country, great. If you don't have the money, you can take it. There's an address. You can send it in later. I go this far. If you pay your tithes and pay your bills, is that the correct order? God's money's first. Okay, mine's always second, okay? If you pay your tithes and pay your bills and you do not have any extra money, okay, and you're tight on money, do some families fall in that category? Yep, some teenagers fall in that category. If there's a financial reason and you don't have the money for this and you want it, you can walk back there and take it for free. It's on me. I'll give it to you. Only stipulation is you have to read it or you have to put it into a lost person's hand after you've chatted with them, okay? Why would I do that? One, I'm a little bit crazy, okay? Two, the other reason is, can you put a price tag on a soul? Give it your best shot. You can't. And if you could, it was paid for 2,000 years ago. You can't put a price tag on a soul, okay? That's why we keep doing it for donation only. We get people who will take cases and pay nothing. We have people get one book and pay $1,000. I don't care. All I pray for is that we have enough money every time we reprint it and to ship it out and every time we've done it. Do we have the money? Of course we do. I serve a great big God that parts Red Seas, okay? Also, if you're not born again, this is my book too. It's free for you. You walk out, just take it free off the table. It's my gift to you for coming, okay, if you're not born again and saved, okay? So when you walk out, when I finish in just a second, one to a person, and if there's any extra, you can start getting extra ones tomorrow for that. I just want to make sure everybody can get one if you want one. And also, you can get multiples at the website, or you can get them at the bookstores and stuff like that, okay? Now watch this as we bring this to a close, all right? Go to verse 19. After all this, after all he just said, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. Verse 19, as many as I love. Did you hear? As many as I love. After all this, you still love us? What is it? This is an unconditional love that we don't understand. Is that right? Come on, you just said you're going to spew me. Nah, as many as I love. Watch what he says. All right. I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and what? Repent. Come, change your mind, change your ways. If you're a 4, 5, and 6, today is the day to repent of that sin. At this altar afterwards, by your bed back at the hotel, I don't care where. If you're living a lukewarm, nasty lifestyle, today is the day to get back on track. He still loves you. 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice, and open up the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me, eat with him and he with me. Have you heard that verse before? It's used numerous times during salvation messages, is that correct? It has nothing to do with salvation. Nothing. He is talking to the lukewarm church. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice. Let me ask you a question, youth groups. If Jesus was knocking at the door, could you hear him? With all your rock music going on, could you hear him? With your iPod thing stuck in your ears, could you hear him if he was knocking? Playing all your video games at your churches, could you hear the Lord if he was knocking? As pizza, yo-yos, and Six Flags are killing the kids today. Killing the kids today. I know a youth pastor in Chicago, he took over a youth group in Chicago, had 12 kids in it. First year, he grew it to 4. 12, he grew it to 4 the first year, got rid of all the pizza, all the yo-yos, all the Six Flags, got all the games, ditched it, got their Bibles out, started reading, started praying, started worshiping, started working at homeless shelters, started street witnessing. 3 years later, running 1,500 youth. He used to take his youth in school buses, load them up around Chicago, drop them off at strip clubs in Chicago. Any of your parents want to send your kids to this youth group by any way? Okay, by any chance? Okay. Drop them off at strip clubs in Chicago. The kids would get off the buses, circle the strip clubs in a circle of prayer, and begin to pray the strip clubs out of Chicago. He told me 6 of them closed down. One closed within 24 hours after his youth showed up. Let me tell you something. When you see God move like that, there is no screen machine. There is no roller coaster. There is no Mall of America that can even begin to compare to that. Is that correct? That is correct. What God are you serving? I'm serving a God that parts Red Seas, parts big Red Seas that people can walk across on dry land. That's even another big miracle if you think about it, okay? But that's the God that I serve. Will you serve the same God? Would you move from the 4, 5, and 6 and walk over to the 8, 9, and 10? That's where you belong as a servant of the Most High God, okay? Think about that. But if, watch what he says, if any man, here's the point. That's why it was the church of the Laodiceans. This is an individual call. He's not calling your youth group to repent. He is not calling your church to repent. He's calling who? You. He's calling the person you see in the mirror every single day. Would you repent today? Would you repent tonight? First time I ever gave this talk, 4,500 teenagers, youth leaders, and all, I started getting these emails from youth leaders repenting of this mediocre, disgusting Christianity they were teaching their kids, and they're on fire for the Lord, just going out there and reaching lost people for Jesus Christ. Young people have been caught up, more concerned about their GPAs and boyfriends and girlfriends and jobs. I said, forget that. I am going to serve the Lord Jesus Christ with all that I've got. It's an individual call. He's knocking. Can you hear him? Or something else got your attention. Judgment day comes. Judgment day sorts everything out, is that correct? Sorts everything out. Let me tell you something, you might have some people call you a little bit crazy, a little bit Jesus freak, okay? A little bit radical, okay? Judgment day sorts it all out, is that right? I'm much more concerned what Jesus says on that day. John 12, do you seek the praises of men or do you seek the praises of God? We all want to hear, well done and good and faithful servant, but are you living a radical, bold, biblical, obedient life that you could actually hear, well done, my good and faithful servant? Think about that, okay? 21, we'll close it for you. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me on my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father on his throne. To he that overcometh, you have the power through Jesus Christ to overcome that sin. Is that correct? You have the power by Jesus Christ to overcome those temptations, that lukewarmness. Will you overcome by his power to sit on his throne? Let me tell you something. If there's a throne to sit on, it would be his throne. Is that correct? Because I could just see somebody sitting there, right there, and there's the Lord just got an arm around him. So let me tell you about this person. Remember this statement. Some of the most famous people you'll ever meet in heaven, some of the wealthiest people you'll ever meet in heaven, you'll have never met or heard about down here. It'll be that faithful grandmother praying all the time for those kids and taking control of her street back in a tough neighborhood and sharing Jesus Christ with those kids. You've never heard her name. She'll be famous in heaven. I know a lady, her whole goal is to reach her entire street for Lord Jesus Christ. She prays for every single house on the street, has met everybody on the street, verbally witnesses to the people, found out the birthday of everybody, bakes cakes, cookies, and pies for the people on their birthdays and stuff. She's seen two entire households repent of their sins and come born again, plugged into her very solid Baptist church. And her goal is all the rest of those houses. That's a lady you'll hear about in heaven one day, okay? Don't think it's all that to be up here with a microphone. Don't think it's all that, okay? I'd rather be a faithful servant of the Most High God, dying, and Jesus Christ saying, well done, my good and faithful servant. You read your Bible. You obeyed what you read. And now enter into reward and come, please, please. Think about that. Please sit with me on my throne. Because I think it's going to be just as much of a joy for Jesus that you're there, that it'll be a joy for you. Interesting to think about, okay? 22 as we close. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Did you listen tonight? Not to the speaker. Did you listen to God's word tonight? How do you look at life? Is it a battleground or is it a playground? I don't go to the Mall of America for a playground. Oh, there's one in there, big one too, okay? I go there because it's a battleground for lost people to chat with about the Lord Jesus Christ. Met some Christian kids in there going to ministry college. Witnessed to them, gave them a book to encourage them on their faith, gave them tracts. I said, young men, let's pray. I prayed for them. I said, now turn around and walk into this mall, okay, and start talking with people. Is that right? That's what we're here for, is to do that, okay? The question is, will you do that? Either lose yourself in the world of Jesus, deny yourself and take up your cross, or deny Jesus and put down the cross. It's your choice, okay? If Jesus is real, you should be all for him. If not, you should be all against him. That's why when I meet lost people that have a hatred for Jesus, it doesn't bother me all that much. At least they're standing up for what they believe, right? It's really true, okay? See, you're either all against him or you're all for him. You can't hang out in 4, 5, and 6. He will spew you out of his mouth. Today is a day. Would you repent? Would you come to the cross of Jesus Christ? Would you leave any nasty sin that's holding you back from being radical? Last question. Can you guarantee me you're going to wake up tomorrow morning? No. I ask it to lost people all the time, and I always tell them the Bible says today's the day of salvation. Don't put your head on your pillow tonight, okay? Don't put your head on your pillow tonight. You know exactly where you're going to spend eternity. I ask you, Christians, can you guarantee me you're going to wake up tomorrow morning? Don't you dare stand before the throne of God, and you won't be standing. You'll be face down. When unholiness sees holiness, you go face down, folks. And it makes you very thankful for a cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? When you die and stand on Judgment Day, a very simple statement, die with no regrets. Die with no regrets. You don't get a second chance at this life. You don't get a mulligan. You don't get a do-over. You got one shot at this life. Is that right? That's right. Give it all you got. Leave all the energy expended on the battleground of earth, okay, and walk out of here as a holy, righteous servant of the Lord, that you've lived a life where you could actually hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. Father, we thank you so much for just a wonderful chance to be here, Father God. Father, by the power of your Holy Spirit, whatever is going on in anybody's life, whatever is going on in their life, Father God, that's keeping them in the 4, 5, and 6 category, if it's a relationship, if it's a degree they're just so hungry for, if it's a sport, if it's an idol worship of some athlete or some rock star, Father, convict it by the power of your Holy Spirit. Father, let them know that it is vomit to you, it is nasty, it's making them sick, it's sick to your stomach, Father God, and it should make our stomach sick as you're trying to drive us to holiness and purity and righteousness. Father God, if that sin needs to repent of tonight, let them repent before they even walk out of here, back at their hotel. Father, remind them it's an individual call. Whether one of their friends ever gets serious about it, they own a mirror. They must look in the mirror. Is this young man, is this mom, is this dad, is this young lady radically sold out for you? Father God, get some people to repent and mold them into warriors for you in the days to come. People will be hearing about for all of eternity in a place called heaven because of the righteous life, the bold life they live for you. And so, Father, we thank you for that, and we do. And we ask it in the great name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Okay. All right. Now.